Throughout our lives, there's going to be instances, naturally, where we make mistakes. And alhamdulillah, it's natural that for most of us, when we make these mistakes, we feel remorse, we feel bad. And so we say to ourselves, I wish I didn't do that, I wish I could do better. But there's something more you can do, and that is to understand the effect of sins. That's what I hope to focus on today. Not just telling yourself, oh, I did something wrong, and it is haram, I feel bad about it, which is good, you're supposed to have remorse. But in addition to that, if you want to help yourself to develop strength, to stay away from evil, it very much is in your interest to learn and understand how is it that these sins are affecting me on an individual, internal basis, on a personal basis with friends and family, on a social basis with the rest of my community and society at large. What is the effect of this sin? The more you learn about this, inshallah ta'ala, the more you will, hopefully, develop the strength to resist and to say no every time you are being tempted to do something evil. So how does it begin? When you do something that is evil, when you do something that is haram and wrong, the first thing that takes place is that a spot gets placed onto your heart. As the Prophet tells us what? إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ إِذَا أَخْطَأَ خَطِيئَةً نُكِتَتْ فِي قَلْبِهِ نُكْتَةٌ سَوْدَاءَ فَإِذَا هُوَ نَزَعَ وَاسْتَغْفَرَ وَتَابَ سُقِلَ قَلْبُهُ وَإِنْ عَادَ زيد فيها حتى تعلو قلبه وهو الران الذي ذكر الله كلا بل ران على قلوبهم ما كانوا يكسبون. The Prophet tells us in a hadith which is authentic, it's in Tirmidhi, the Prophet tells us what? Indeed, when the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commits a sin, then a dark spot is placed on their heart. And when they refrain from that sin and seek repentance for that sin, then that heart becomes polished clean. So the hadith is not saying stay away from sin entirely. Never do wrong. That's not possible. But at least you know it's going to get dirty. Just like if I told you, imagine a person saying, oh, don't worry, I took such a good shower, I'm never going to take a shower again. You'd say, look, buddy, it doesn't work like that. You know, you're going to have to regularly shower. That's the way life goes. Nobody can just stay clean all the time. You can't say, I did such a good cleaning that, you know, that's it. That's the last one I'll ever need. It doesn't work like that. You're a human being. You're going to need regular showering. In the same way, you're going to make mistakes. And you're going to need regular what? Repentance and tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep on cleansing and polishing that heart. However, if a person just keeps returning to that sin, and instead of feeling bad about it, they start to override that guilt and start to tell themselves, you know what, I embrace it. It's okay for me, I'm going to justify it. Maybe it's wrong for everybody else, but I have reasons, I have excuses. And they start to embrace it. They start to feel good about it. They start to take pictures of themselves while they do it and put it to the whole world. Share it with their friends. They start to tell the story. You wouldn't believe the time I did this and that. And they're proud of it. They're bragging about it. When they embrace the evil, then what happens? Now that one spot, instead of being washed away, becomes two, three, four, and now a rust starts to develop. And this is exactly the description of what Allah Ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Mutaffifin, when Allah says what? كَلَّا بَلْ رَانَ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبِهِمْ مَا كَانُوا يَكْسِبُونَ. Allah says, no, but on their hearts is a ran, is a rust from what they used to earn. In other words, this rust that starts to develop on top of the heart, that starts to make it rough, that starts to make it coated in such a way where it is no longer lenient and open-hearted and open-minded and open to in new information, you become stubborn and harsh-hearted and a difficult person. This is happening because of what you used to earn. Don't go around blaming others. It was you that embraced evil, and this is the result of it, number one. What is the second result? Well, it goes from stage one to stage two. Now that you have this coat, now that you have this rust around your heart, what takes place? The light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not penetrate through. The whole objective is what? That Allah Ta'ala has revealed so much nur. In fact, Allah Ta'ala describes this Quran as nur. And so this is the guidance, this is light. But if you put a barrier, if you build up this rust, then subhanAllah, ilm does not come through. And this is called hirmanul ilm, prevention, being prevented from accepting knowledge. And this is so important that Allah Ta'ala put it right at the beginning of the Quran. بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم ألف لام ميم ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. That this Quran, there is no doubt within it. This book, there is no doubt within it. It is a guidance for everybody? No. Because some people, they don't have taqwa. Some people, they have done so much evil. They always fall into sin. They always know that something is wrong, but they want to do it anyway. So what happens? As a result of that, the light of the Quran does not penetrate. This is only going to be a huda. This is only going to be a guidance for who? Al-muttaqeen. Those who can actually say no and say and stop themselves, prevent themselves from their most base and evil desires. And if you want a simple analogy, think of it this way. If you're lost and you're looking to find out where's the nearest gas station, and I tell you, oh, don't worry. You go forward, you take a left, you take a left, then you take a right, or something like this, right? I give you the most perfect, most clear guidance, directions. If you're too lazy, if you're too weak, if you're uninterested, if you're too easily distracted to actually stick to the path that I just gave you, what good is all the guidance? What benefit will there be? How will it benefit you? You'll never get to where you're going. Not because I don't know how to guide you, because you can't apply it. You don't have the discipline to stick the course. Allah Ta'ala is saying, listen, this is a guidance for those who actually can apply it, for those who have taqwa, for those who can say no to their base desires and say yes to what Allah has commanded, to those who can stop the evil of what Allah Ta'ala has prevented and to embrace the commands of Allah. If you can do that, then it's going to be guidance for you. If not, then yeah, I can tell you the direction to go and you won't take it. You're too lazy, too stubborn, too distracted, too heedless, whatever the case may be. So subhanAllah, this is mentioned right at the beginning of Baqarah. Why? Because it's so important. And amazingly, that same lesson is retaught near the end of Baqarah as well. When Allah Ta'ala tells us what? وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ وَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهِ. Putting these two together, subhanAllah. Allah is saying what? Have taqwa of Allah. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remove the rust from your heart. Actually apply what you know, and Allah is going to keep teaching you. If not, then the rust is going to increase, and you will not allow the light of Allah Ta'ala to penetrate through. So effect number one, rust over your heart. Effect number two, guidance does not have an effect. The light of Allah Ta'ala does not penetrate through. What is the point number three? Because of that, because you refuse guidance, because you have made yourself a person who cannot receive guidance, the quality of your life will decrease. That's point number three. The quality of your life is going to decrease. Both quality and quantity, subhanAllah. You may live a shorter life, and the life that you live is not going to have as much blessing within it. How do we know this? Because the Prophet tells us what? لَا يَزِيدُ فِي الْعُمْرِ إِلَّا الْبِرْ. Nothing increases a person's life, and here, increasing their life in both quality and quantity. وَاللَّهُ تَعَالَىٰ أَعْلَمُ. Nothing increases it except what? Birr, righteousness. Therefore, مفهوم المخالفة, if you therefore, ipso facto, switch it and look at it from the opposite perspective, if you embrace evil, then it's going to decrease both the quality and quantity of your life. And the second part of the hadith is what? وَلَا يَرُدُّ الْقَدْرِ إِلَّا الدُّعَى. And nothing repels qadr, nothing repels what is destined for you except for dua. In other words, if you were destined to get into an accident today, but you made the proper du'as before getting up, you asked Allah for protection, you asked Allah Ta'ala to save you from evil, then subhanAllah, could be that what was destined for you will actually be prevented, and Allah knows best. So, subhanAllah, your quality of life will decrease, and this is exactly why Allah Ta'ala describes the difference between the believer and the disbeliever is like the quality between the living and the dead. SubhanAllah. Listen to this. Allah Ta'ala says what? وَمَا يَسْتَوِي الْحَيَاءُ وَمَا يَسْتَوِي الْأَحْيَاءُ وَلَا الْأَمْوَاتُ. That not equal are those who are living and those who are dead. And this is a description of who? The believers versus disbelievers. They're like the living versus the dead. This is how Allah describes them. Why? It's like the difference between saying, this person is alive, but they're not really living. Let's give an example. Imagine somebody is stuck in jail. Technically, they're alive, right? They're breathing, they're eating, but they're not living their life. It's not a real good life that they're living. They're not free to do what they want. They're not enjoying their friends and family and loved ones. They're stuck in a jail, so they're alive, but they're not really living. What if you're stuck bedridden? You're sick and you can't move because you have such a disease or whatever the case is. You're alive, but you're not really living. In that same way, Allah is describing what? If you don't know your purpose in life, if you don't know right from wrong, if you don't know how to be a good person that will get closer to Allah and feel and taste spirituality, and you don't know how to prepare for the next life, and you're just completely lost in life, then yes, technically you're alive, but you're not really living. You haven't figured out what life is about. So they're not the same. The one who is alive and those who are dead. Describing the believers versus the disbelievers. May Allah Ta'ala protect us. May Allah Ta'ala make us of those who are living. And so inshallah ta'ala, in the next second khutbah, I want to go into more detail. What does it mean that the quality of your life is going to decrease? SubhanAllah, there are many different factors that relate to this in Quran and Sunnah, and inshallah ta'ala we'll explore them. Wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam Muhammad wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathira. Bismillah, bismillah, walhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. So what does it mean that the quality of your life is going to decrease the more you embrace sin? Well, we know that firstly, the quality of your life will decrease because your rizq, your provisions, will be decreased. As Allah Ta'ala says, what? وَمَن يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجْعَل لَّهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. Allah Ta'ala tells us what? Whoever fears Allah, He is going to give him a way out. You're in a tight spot, you're in a bad situation, you're financially constrained. Allah Ta'ala is telling you what? I'm going to give you a way out. And what? وَيَرْزُقْهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. I'm going to provide you rizq from places you could not imagine. You could never imagine that wealth and happiness was going to come from this direction. And subhanAllah, Allah Ta'ala blessed you with it. Why? Because you decided to stay away from evil. Why don't we make this part of our strategy? Why don't we make this part of our financial planning? I'm not saying throw caution to the wind. I'm not saying don't get the degree. No, of course, go get the degree. Put out your CV. Give out your resume. Make sure you apply yourself. Make sure you try hard to increase in your wealth. Absolutely. But part of your strategy should be what? One additional factor should be, Ya Allah, I'm also going to make sure that this sin, I'm going to cut it out of my life. And that one, I'm going to cut these out of my life. Why? Because when I have taqwa, I know that your promise is, with increase of taqwa, what's going to happen? You're going to provide for me in ways that I could not expect. Maybe because of your taqwa, you're going to start applying the advice that your parents have been giving you for all these years. And you're going to see that it really pays off. Maybe you're going to make connections. Maybe you're going to network and meet people that you would have never otherwise met. You're going to make good impressions. Your good character is going to really rub off in a way that, subhanAllah, this person says, you know, I think you'd be great for this position. You seem like a hardworking person. You seem so positive. We really want you part of our company. And subhanAllah, you say, Ya Allah, look at that. I increased in taqwa. I developed my character. I worked harder. I was better to my friends and family. I increased in taqwa. Ya Allah, you opened doors that I could have never seen. I could have never foreseen. So let's make this part of our strategies when we are financially planning. Say, Ya Allah, in addition to what everybody else is planning, I'm going to have one extra strategy that they're not going to expect. I'm going to have one extra way of increasing my likelihood of just beating the competition. What? Because I know that I have something they don't have. What is that? Taqwallah. Allah's going to give me that little extra edge in terms of my finances. This is one possibility. Furthermore, Allah's going to prevent you from humiliation. Those who do sins privately and embrace it and enjoy it and never feel remorse, and then they go in public and they want to act like a different person. Essentially, they are two-faced. Such people, they will only be able to fool the masses for so long. Why? Because Allah Ta'ala will expose you. At the end of the day, if you embrace being two-faced, if you, all of us have some degree of, you know, maybe a little bit more evil in private, a little bit more polishing ourselves up in public. That's going to happen because you can't be 100% at your best game all the time because you're not a robot. But if you completely don't care, you embrace evil entirely in private, and then you completely put on a show in public, subhanAllah, don't think it's going to last. You will be exposed. As Allah Ta'ala says, what? وَمَن يُهِنِ اللَّهُ فَمَا لَهُ مِن مُكْرِمٍ. And whoever Allah humiliates, for him, there is no bestower of honor. In other words, if you want to keep on doing evil, never think that you can hide from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Ta'ala knows what you're doing. And Allah Ta'ala is going to expose you. It doesn't matter where you go. It doesn't matter where you hide. The truth is going to come out. So fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and try your best to repent for whatever evil you have done. And always repent whenever you do an increase in evil. What is another way that your quality of life decreases when you embrace sin? You're going to have relationship issues. If you don't remember anything else from this khutbah, just remember this one point, inshallah ta'ala. Nothing else, fine. Just remember this one point. Remember this hadith, subhanAllah. The Prophet ﷺ tells us what? This is also in Al-Adab Al-Mufrad, and it is a authentic hadith. مَا تَوَادَّثْنَانِ فِي اللَّهِ جَلَّ وَعَزَّ أَوْ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ فَيُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَهُمَا إِلَّا بِذَنْبٍ يُحْدِثُ أَحَدُهُمَا. That the Prophet ﷺ says what? Two people do not love each other for the sake of Allah or for the sake of Islam, and then they split up. There's some sort of problem between them. They have some sort of issue that breaks them apart. Long-term relationships, friends from high school, friends from grade school, neighbors that used to be buddies, or even a relationship, marriage, or maybe even children, or parents, or whatever the case is. Two people who love each other for Allah's sake. And by the way, marriage is definitely for Allah's sake, because the whole concept of the institution of marriage is a religious institution to begin with. So subhanAllah, you don't find that these two people are going to split up except for what? Illa, what? Illa bidhanbin, because of a sin, yuhtithuhu ahaduhuma, because of a sin that one of them has done. Look, I'm not saying don't go see a marriage counselor. I'm not saying don't go to therapy. I'm not saying don't listen to your spouse or your children or your parents a little bit more. Yes, do all of the well-known, established methods in order to increase, inshallah ta'ala, in mending those bonds. Absolutely. Conventionalism is conventional for a reason. We should apply it. But add this to your arsenal. Add this to your strategy. And say to yourself, Ya Allah, if I'm having problems at home, if I'm having problems with my friends or family members, you know what? Maybe there's a specific sin that I've done that has drained the barakah from my life to such an extent that it's not going to go away. This fighting is not going to go away. The tension in the home is not going to go away. Until what? Until I say, Ya Allah, I'm going to submit. I'm going to let go of what evil I've done. I'm going to drop whatever I've done. I'm going to look inwardly instead of always pointing the finger outwardly. I'm going to start finally look inwardly and say, what can I cut out of my life? And bi-idhnillah, Allah Ta'ala is going to make things easier. And subhanAllah, there's a beautiful quote from Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, rahimahullah, who, you know, very knowledgeable, famous scholar, and he summarizes this idea so beautifully when he says,
إِنِّي لَأَعْصِ اللَّهَ فَأَعْرِفُ ذَلِكَ فِي خُلُقِ حِمَارِي وَخَادِمِي وَامْرَأَتِي وَفَأْرِ بَيْتِي.
SubhanAllah. He says, I'll disobey Allah, and then I'll recognize the negative effects of this disobedience in the behavior of my ride, like even my donkey. I'll realize something's wrong. I'll see the negative effects even in my ride, and in my servants, whoever works for me, and in my wife, and even in the mice in my house. فَأْرِ بَيْتِي. Even the mice in my house, I feel like the infestation gets worse. They start eating in my savings or my food and so forth. SubhanAllah, he's saying, I'm seeing the effects. Every time I fall into more evil, everything starts falling apart. Nowadays, we'd say, in the home, maybe even infestations of ants or whatever the case is, my phone starts freezing up or bugging out, my car doesn't start working, starts having problems, whatever the case is, things start to fall apart. Why? Because the barakah of my life is being drained. I need to stop this. I need to figure out what I'm doing wrong, and I need to apply Allah Ta'ala's deen, have taqwa of Allah, and stop resisting. Why? Because it's only going to get worse. So then when this takes place, when your relationships start to deteriorate, what is the next natural step? The next step is what? That you become a burden to those who are around you. You become a burden to society. You become a burden to this world, in fact. As the Prophet says, Abu Qatada ibn Rib'i al-Ansari, rahimahullah, radiyallahu anhu, he says what? أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم مر عليه بجنازة فقال مستريح ومستراح منه. One time a janazah was passing by, a funeral procession was passing by the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And as he's seeing this funeral procession pass by, he says what? Relieved or relieving? And the Sahaba hear this and say, Ya Rasulullah, what does this mean? Relieved or relieving, what does this mean? And then he explains, العبد المؤمن يستريح من نصب الدنيا وأذاها إلى رحمة الله والعبد الفاجر يستريح منه العباد والبلاد والشجر والدواب. The Prophet tells us what? This is in Sahih Bukhari. That he tells them, a believer is relieved by death. He is relieved. Why? He's relieved from the troubles and the hardships of this world, and he goes to the mercy of Allah. So he gets to die and become relieved. Oh, finally, I get to get out of this dunya with all the sins and evil and problems. I'm done. And he gets relieved to the mercy of Allah. Whereas the fajr, the wicked slave, the disobedient individual, the world is relieved from him. He is relieving them. He is relieving them. Why? Because they were a burden. Because this individual was a burden to society. Why? Because all they added was evil, ma'asiyah. All they added was ithm. All they added was more udwan. All they added was more enmity, frustration, pain. Why? Because the more you do sin, the more you remove barakah, and subhanAllah, it can have so much of a negative effect. As Allah says, ظَهَرَ الْفَسَادُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ بِمَا كَسَبَتْ أَيْدِ النَّاسِ. That corruption has appeared throughout the land and the sea because of what the hands of people have earned. In other words, never think that your sin is isolated. If you do something wrong at work, it can have an effect on the masjid. If you do something wrong at the park, it may have an effect at home. If you do something wrong on the road, it may have an effect with your kids. SubhanAllah. Never think that it just has some isolated effect. No, that's not the case. The evil that you do can create so many ripple effects that we don't fully comprehend within yourself and within others as well. So do you want to be the type of person who is so wicked that subhanAllah, the world, as the hadith mentions, that the person who is a fajr, who is a wicked person, he relieves the people, the land, the trees, and even the animals. Everything is happy that you're gone. We don't want to be that type of person at all. We want to be those who, subhanAllah, the world is going to grieve our loss, and that, subhanAllah, we will be relieved because we get to walk away from this test and retire to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when we pass away. May Allah ta'ala make us of those who are of benefit. to humanity. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. So try your best to be positive. Try your best to always do good so that you can be a barakah to your community and to your family and to the people around you. Try to have a smile as the Prophet ﷺ would smile often. Try to have uplifting words. Try to remind people with Quran and Sunnah. Try to have a positive demeanor in general. And stop pointing the finger. If you see negativity at work or in your money or in your family, yes, of course, you can find everybody else's flaws. But what good does that do? At the end of the day, become the example. Instead, say, what can I do? How can I make it part of my strategy? Say, Ya Allah, whatever I'm doing wrong, I'm gonna start cutting out this evil and that evil, these habits and those habits. I'm gonna start cutting out these addictions and those addictions. Why? Because Ya Allah, I know you can improve my circumstances. So to summarize, when you do a sin, number one, first thing happens, your heart begins to rust over. Number two, because of that rust, the light of Allah does not penetrate through. And then number three, what happens? That the quality of your life begins to decrease. You might ask, how does my quality of life decrease? Well, you are deprived of rizq. Then in addition to that, you are going to feel the humiliation of that evil laid upon you, and you will see that others notice it as well, that Allah Ta'ala is going to expose you. Number three, you're going to find relationship issues. In all of your relationships, you will find that it starts to suffer and starts to deteriorate. And because your relationships are getting worse, because of that, society will see you as a burden. You'll become a burden onto society, and the world will be relieved by your departure. SubhanAllah, may Allah Ta'ala protect us from all of these evils. This is terrible and scary. And SubhanAllah, if you're paying close attention, you'll realize that these are all effects in the dunya. I didn't even mention what happens to you in the grave. I didn't mention what's going to happen to you on Judgment Day. And I didn't mention what's going to happen to you in the afterlife in Jahannam. May Allah Ta'ala protect us all. Obviously, those are the greater and even worse consequences. This is just a small idea of what takes place within this dunya. SubhanAllah, may Allah protect us. So may Allah Ta'ala make us of those who always look internally at what we can do to improve our circumstances. May Allah Ta'ala make it part of our strategy, whether it be financial or whether it be social, whether it be from a familiar perspective. May Allah Ta'ala make it part of our strategy to say, Ya Allah, let me cut out these sins so I can improve in whatever capacity I can within all the realms of my life. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. Allahumma hadina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa barik lana fi ma a'tayt, wa qina sharra ma qadayt, fa innaka taqdi wa la yuqda alayk, innahu la yadhillu man walayt, wa la ya'izzu man adayt. Tabarakta Rabbana wa ta'alayt, Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana, wa fil akhirati hasana, wa qina adhaban nar, wa sallallahu ala sallam Muhammad, wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam taslima kathira, wa aqim as-salah.